In this video, we'll take a look at how to find predicted scores or predicted values in multiple regression. And finding predicted values is really very helpful because if we can get an understanding of what a predicted value is, that will really help to unlock many of the features of multiple regression. We can better understand what's going on with a number of different measures, including, for example, R, R squared, what a residual is, which we'll talk about in another video, and so on. It really does help quite a bit. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. Here on your screen, you see an equation, and this equation says y hat equals a plus b1 times x1 plus b2 times x2. And then here, y hat is equal to the predicted value for an observation. So in other words, what is the actual value that we get in terms of predicting y or our dependent variable or criterion variable as a direct result of our regression analysis? So what does our regression analysis predict for the dependent or criterion variable? And A is known as the y-intercept. And mathematically, that's just the value of y hat when all of the x's are zero. So in other words, if you look at this, and this x was 0 here, and this x was 0 here, then multiplying that out, that would just be y hat equals a, as these terms would just become 0. So that's why the y-intercept is defined as the value of y hat when all x's are 0. And then b1 and b2 are what are referred to as the unstandardized regression coefficients for, in this case, since we have two, the first and second predictors, respectively. And then x1 and x2 are the score or scores on the first and second predictors, respectively. So SAT score of 1200, that's our x1, and then the social support score of 62, that's our x2 here. So we could run the regression analysis in SPSS, and we get a table of output, but I've gone ahead and done that here. And you can see it right here, the coefficients table. This is the table that we want to use to get the values for our equation to find a predicted score. And we'll go ahead and do this in a little while. I'll run this again and show you how I got this just to be complete. But in this analysis, I went ahead and adjusted the decimal places so that they would be output to 5 decimal places. And that's not always necessary, but when I have very small values, like notice this is 0.00172. This is basically 2/100. This is 1/1000. When they're that small, it can be helpful to carry them out to more decimal places in order to get an accurate predicted score. But in many cases, our variables, our independent variables or predictors, get these B values that are much larger than this, and we don't have to be as concerned about carrying them out beyond the standard default of 2 decimal places. But when they're small like this, I like to do that for accuracy. So here's our equation once again, y hat equals a plus b1 x1 plus b2 x2. And my constant is the a, so 0.03238. Notice that goes right here. And then the b1 is the capital B here, unstandardized coefficients, for my first predictor, which is SAT score. So I have 0.00172, so that's why you see this right here. And then that's multiplied by SAT score, and that is the actual score that an individual got on the SAT. And then my next unstandardized coefficient is for social support, and that's 0.02164, so that's why you see that here. And then that's multiplied by the individual's social support score. So now that we have the basic equation, let's go ahead and solve one on our own. So here, notice for the first person, they got a 1200 on the SAT, and their social support score was 62. So we use that equation that we saw a minute ago, and here it is once again, and then we plug in 1200 here for SAT, since that's their SAT score, and 62 for social support, since that's their social support score. And when we do that, we find the following. So here's our equation once again, and notice here now I have the 1200 plugged in, and the 62 plugged in as well. And that works out to a predicted score of 3.43806. So in other words, using the predictors SAT score and social support, using those independent variables, we get a predicted GPA value of about 3.44 if we rounded two decimal places here. And notice the actual GPA is 3.45. So we had a value that was very close. This is called 3.44, and the actual is 3.45. So our regression analysis, our regression equation, got very close to the actual value. We got 3.44 once again, and the actual value was 3.45. So we're only off by 0.01. And that's very good. And that's actually, that won't be the case using this equation for all of these values, the SAT and social support scores. If we plug all of these in and got predicted values, they all wouldn't be that close, because that really is quite outstanding. But many will be close, some will be further away. And our R squared for this problem, the bigger the R squared, the closer it is to 1. Recall, that indicates the amount of variance R squared, the amount of variance that's accounted for in the dependent variable from the predictors. And if our R squared is big, that means we're accounting for a lot of variance in the dependent variable, or in college GPA in this case. So the bigger the R squared, the more variance we account for. The bigger the R squared, overall, on average, the closer these predicted values will be to the actual values. Okay, so if your R squared is very large, these predicted values will be very close to the actual values. If your R squared is low or small, then the predicted values will tend to be further away from the actual values. So the better these predictors do at predicting college GPA, or the dependent variable, the higher the R squared. And likewise, the closer our actual predicted values will be to the values on the dependent variable.